Chapter 9. The Beatles Story. In October 1971, Mark White called me into his office for a chat, the consequences of which were going to have a big impact on my life. "Johnny, we have a word that an American company, Watermark, are putting together the definitive Elvis Presley story, based on the recent book by Jerry Hopkins. We've decided to buy it, and we'd like you to work with Watermark, the production company, take out the commercial breaks and edit it so that it's suitable for BBC transmission." A job that was right up my street, and I was thrilled to be offered it. "But that's not all," Mark went on. "We also have the word that Watermark's next project is going to be the Beatles story, and we can't possibly have an American company make a series about Britain's biggest band, so we're proposing that the BBC should do it. We wondered if you'd like to take charge of the project. If so, we want the first programme to be ready by March 1972. Well, luckily for me, he later relaxed this deadline a little, and the series finally started going out on May the 21st that year. It was a fantastic opportunity, but it meant that I had to drop all my other commitments and get stuck in right away. It's hard to imagine how big the Beatles were in the 1970s and what a huge task it was to document their story. The first major problem was that, despite the prestige of the BBC being behind the project, they'd experienced so much overexposure at the hands of the media that there appeared no chance the Beatles would give us official cooperation. It would all have to be done by tracking down and interviewing all those involved with the story. To support their tales, we'd need to find as much existing Beatle interview material as we could. The BBC archives, of course, had retained most of the formal appearances, but there was a lot more unofficial stuff to find. All of this would need to be assembled in chronological order. Only when I had all of this could I start to think about the outline of the 12 one-hour episodes and consider a scriptwriter and narrator. One last problem was the story, of course, had not ended. As long as they were still alive, anything John, Paul, George or Ringo did was news. So, with my assistant Jane Paramore, I set to work. The first thing to do was to read every book ever written about the group and draw up a list of significant people I would need to interview. The Beatles' Apple organisation was crucial and luckily offered their full cooperation. They gave me a couple of private publications listing all the recording and performance activities of the group. Hunter Davis' biography, The Beatles, provided a wonderful overview, and then there were many, many articles to investigate. About 4 weeks reading to start with, and I'd completed that work by Christmas. I compiled a list which was about 150 people who I thought would be useful to talk to. On January the 10th, Jane and I were off up the M6 through the fog to Liverpool to start finding early friends and relations. It didn't prove to be easy. In my diary I wrote, "Phoned Bob Wooler, the former Cavern compere, who couldn't see us till Thursday. He had prepared a list a mile long of everyone he thought we should interview. Met up with Frieda Kelly, who was their fan club secretary. Tuesday, January the 11th. We met Mrs. Best, the mother of Pete Best, but she had the flu and would only think about giving us an interview. Returned to Frieda Kelly, who told us that everyone she had approached on our behalf, George's parents, Ringo's parents, and the McCartneys, were unwilling to cooperate. Tried to get George Harrison, a journalist with Liverpool Echo, but failed. But did finally make contact with Clive Epstein, Brian's brother, but he and his mother couldn't see us for a day or two. At the end of that first day, I managed to get an interview with Rory Storm's mum, Irene Caldwell. She turned out to be quite a character." And so it went on. Gradually, I managed to record significant people like Alan Williams. Alan had promoted the very first concerts, and he and Bob Wooler had been a key part of the Cavern Club. Alan, acting as the earliest sort of manager, told them they had to get a drummer, so they found one, a chap called Tommy Moore. He told me one day Tommy didn't show up for one of the gigs, and Alan had booked them in at the Grosvenor Ballroom in Wallasey. So he went to Tommy's house, and Tommy's wife stuck her head out of the upstairs window and shouted at Alan, "I'm fed up with all this pop nonsense. Tommy's got a job on the night shift at Garston Bottleworks, so he can piss off." So Alan went to the Bottleworks and found Tommy, who said, "Well, it's the missus, she won't have it. So I've got to get a job and I can't drum any more." With Tommy out, they took on Pete Best, the son of the lady who owned a club they played in. It was Alan Williams who went over to Hamburg with his homemade tape recordings of the boys, trying to get them work. He sold the idea to Bruno Koschmider, asking for a fee of £100 a week for the band and £10 commission for Alan. It was a fortune for the boys who'd been lucky to get 10 bob, that's 50p today a night, for their UK gigs. What they didn't realise, of course, was that they would be expected to play from 7pm till 2 or 3 in the morning every single night. Having achieved limited success in Germany, Alan approached prop promoter Larry Parnes to get them a booking on a British tour, and Larry told me how the Silver Beatles, as they were then called, were always hard up. He said, "One day John comes on the phone, 'Larry, where's the bloody money? We're broke, we're skint.' I said, 'But you haven't worked this week out yet, John. In fact, you haven't even started the week.' And John said, 'I know, but you said if we got short, we could have a sub.' So I said, 'How much do you want?' 5 pounds each,' said John. And every week after that, he would be on, acting as a spokesman, always asking, 'Where's the bloody money?' So it went on. I'd collected some good stories during our first week in Liverpool and was ready to go back to London. Next stop was Hamburg, Germany. I went there at the end of January, and it was like an overblown Soho. I didn't know which way to look. Neon signs flashing, girls in provocative costumes posing in the doorways, and clubs with music blaring out of every building, all the way along the Reeperbahn. The people there, though, were much more cooperative and open than those in Liverpool. I recorded Klaus Willerhaus, the local concert promoter, and his associate Frank Dostel, Manfred Wieslider of the Star Club, and Tony Sheridan, who'd been a singer in the Silver Beatles. Tony told me how the Beatles had lived in an attic, and there was a little old German lady whose job it was to bring up a bucket of hot water once a day for us to wash in, and how they collected war memorabilia, badges, swastikas and uniforms, and John would dress up in them and give her all sorts of grief. The group would use these props on stage, doing outrageous things to gain attention. They would call the audience Nazi swine and other names in an effort to be different. Having got as much information as I could, in the words used by all News of the World reporters, I made my excuses and left, feeling I had achieved my objectives in Germany. In February, back in the UK, I tracked down a rare 30-minute interview with Brian Epstein. Music recordings of the Silver Beatles singing Lucille in Hamburg. Rare recordings in the Cavern when Ringo first played drums in public. That was with the Beatles. I met up with Neil Aspinall, who runs the Apple office, and Tony King, who knows everyone who is anyone. The list was building, and it was frightening just how many people I needed to talk to in such a short time in order to understand the complete picture. In mid-February, I set off for America, and first stop was New York. I had a very good reception there, great fun running around the corporate offices, and people were very cooperative. One of the first people I spoke to was Sid Bernstein. He'd put on the Shea Stadium concerts, then Murray the K, a DJ on WABC, who championed their records, and I even managed to see television star Ed Sullivan. Perhaps the scariest incident was meeting Alan Klein. I went along there one evening and I was left in no doubt that I was in the company of a very heavy player, not a man to fool around with. If you want a good description of him, just listen to the Beatles recording of Come Together. John wrote it all about Alan Klein. It's all in there. No small talk. Just ask your questions and if I like them, I'll answer. If not, tough. In the end, Alan and I didn't fall out. He gave me some useful answers about the business side and all the problems associated with the split between the members of the group. I don't intend to retell the Beatles story here. Too much has been written on that subject, but over 90 hours of tape were collected. A good thing about a group as popular as the Beatles is that they have been interviewed so many times. Once you have assembled a comprehensive library, you can find their answers and comments on almost any topic. My job was akin to solving an enormous jigsaw puzzle, fitting all the pieces together. It was an enormous amount of work, but with help from my assistant Jane, we managed it. We sorted out all the possible comments and quotes into chronological sequences and edited the relevant pieces. Then came the question of who should write the story. I considered all sorts of experts, but decided that after all the research, I had the best and most comprehensive knowledge of the material, so I wrote it myself. I had to choose a narrator, and there was only one broadcaster who had experienced it all and lived through it. He was Brian Matthew. When he had been on Saturday Club, he had worked with the Beatles on numerous occasions and had even been to America on tour with them. It was a pleasure putting the shows together with him, and he often chipped in little suggestions and rewrites of my original script, which made it read better. and the announcer was another old chum chosen for his superb voice and wonderful diction, Alan Dell. Finally, the opening programme was finished in time for the first transmission. The BBC lashed out on some twiglets and cheap red wine at a press launch, and even the staff magazine Ariel came and wrote a special feature. Our work wasn't done because there were still another 12 episodes to record, but we knew where we were going. The broadcast finally started transmission at 5 p.m. on Sunday, the 21st of May, 1972, on both Radios 1 and 2, and we had a full colour cover and feature in the Radio Times. It was pretty well received in the press, with one exception. I was hurt by Gillian Reynolds' criticisms in the Daily Telegraph. I respected her as a wide journalist who knew a lot about radio, but she was a Liverpudlian and hated the series and didn't have a good word to say about it. I suppose she was expecting a more intellectual and analytical approach to a subject she regarded as her own, whereas I had adopted a populist storytelling one. I was sorry she'd not enjoyed it, but millions did. The Beatles story became one of the BBC Transcription Service's biggest ever sellers. It was broadcast in nearly every English-speaking territory in the world and was even translated into Spanish in a version for South America. I finished the series, and when it was repeated in the summer of 1973, I had to update Programme 13 and write a new Episode 14 to conclude the story. Paul McCartney had heard it by then and was very complimentary. He said, "I thought it was incredible, actually, because half the things you heard in there I just didn't know. You heard what this publisher thought, and what that manager thought. It's interesting, and I'm glad it was all encapsulated like that. It helped me, because that was it. But it's finished now, folks. That's why it couldn't start up again. It's been done. The obituary's been written, and it's been laid to rest. Beatles R.I.P. And now, long live the individuals." Well, by then I'd been promoted to a position of executive producer, so my workload was changing, and we would go on at the BBC to make many more stories of. I'd started a new trend for home-produced popular music documentaries on Radio 1. I had set a standard, and it was all up to the other producers working for me to carry on that tradition of telling stories which would explain more about the music we played on Radio 1. Over the years we made many such stories, the Beach Boys, the Rolling Stones, Simon and Garfunkel, and many others, culminating in 26 parts of the complete Story of Pop.